This is the end of RH Saga Season 1. Previously, the aim was to give at least a rough overview of the major lines of thought that might point towards a possible future new geometry of L functions. Today, we will take one final look at the historical origins of the idea of F1. And then I will present a proof of the Riemann hypothesis. A lot of inspiration, both for the Langlands program and for the idea of F1, comes from Weil's Rosetta Stone. This is a reference to a letter that André Weil wrote to his philosopher sister Simone Weil in 1940. In this letter, he described in rather poetic terms the nature of his mathematical research and some of his mathematical dreams. In Edward Frankel's Love and Math, all of chapter 9 is dedicated to this idea. And the idea is that there are three parallel worlds. Number fields, function fields over a finite field, and function fields over the complex numbers. These worlds are similar, but also different in some quite mysterious ways. There are versions of the Langlands program for all three. There is a Riemann hypothesis for each of the first two, and there is a geometric interpretation for the last two. Because the geometric interpretation for function fields gives a path to the Riemann hypothesis there. That's the story of local zeta functions we saw last time. It seems reasonable to ask if there could be a geometric interpretation also in this global case or the number field case. And this is one of the main sources for the original dream of F1. So I want to make a few comments on this Rosetta Stone picture. First, when we speak of geometry over a finite field or over the complex numbers, there are always two completely distinct types of geometry. And I will now invent the words deep geometry and shallow geometry just to describe these two paradigms. In the Rosetta Stone, in the last two columns, we work either over a finite field or over the complex numbers. What I mean by this is that when you have an equation, like any of those equations we had before, you study the solutions in finite fields here, and you study the complex solutions here. In both of these cases, it's pretty hard to draw pictures, and therefore I will draw pictures using real numbers, which aren't even on the Rosetta Stone. But the principles carry over to both the complex numbers and to finite fields. What I mean by deep geometry is a setting where the geometric objects are points of dimension 0, curves of dimension 1, surfaces of dimension 2, and so on. In deep geometry, there is a tensor structure where you can take the Cartesian product of, for example, one curve with another curve, and that gives a surface. If you have dimension 3 times dimension 4, that would be dimension 7. In shallow geometry, it's different. You have a line. In my picture, this is just the real line. And a geometric object is a curve with a projection map to the line. Here is a typical picture. In this example, most points on the line have three pre-images, so this geometric object has degree 3. But some points have fewer. This would then be called a branch point, and this would be called a ramification point. In this kind of geometry, every object is a curve with a map to the line. If some curve has two different maps to the line, that would count as two distinct geometric objects. So every object has the same dimension, but they have different degree. And the degree is the number of sheets, so to speak, in this covering, or the typical number of pre-image points. The key point now is that in shallow geometry, there is also a tensor structure, where the basic idea is that for each point on the line, you take the Cartesian product of the finite sets above that point. So degree 3 times degree 4 would now be of degree 12, completely different from the deep case. There is also another key difference, namely that in the shallow setting, the tensor product involves two steps. Roughly speaking, you first take this Cartesian product of finite sets above each point, but then you get a curve with singularities. So in the second step, you take a normalization of that curve. That's just a procedure for removing the singularities. We could think of this as a main step followed by a correction step. The point I want to make is that when we try to find a geometry for L functions, we need to be clear about whether we are looking for something like a deep geometry or something like a shallow geometry. In the Rosetta Stone, each of the last two geometric interpretations are of type shallow geometry. Here you have curves over the projective line, and here you have Riemann surfaces over the Riemann sphere. There is a kind of geometric interpretation already, also in the number field case, since you can use this language of schemes to describe number fields and their rings of integers. Sometimes you will see the scheme spec Z, which is in some ways like a line. All prime numbers are points, like we want, and you can use something called Arakelov theory to also get an extra point or the infinite prime. The problem with using schemes in the global case is that there is no way to make sense of all L functions in terms of shallow geometry. There is a deep geometry for motivic L functions where objects do have different dimensions. Number fields have dimension 0, elliptic curves have dimension 1, there are surfaces and so on. But this problem that there is no shallow geometry, this is inherited whenever you try to build some F1 geometry based on schemes. So what I believe is that one key to F1 could be to completely give up the idea that schemes are part of the language for global L functions, and instead look for some other kind of line where the prime numbers are points, and then look for a geometry where every L function comes from a curve over this line. So a shallow geometry over F1. If this could be made precise, then there could also later be another new deep geometry built on top of that. That's how things do work for the other two columns of the Rosetta Stone. And then, maybe, possibly, if all L functions come from curves, maybe the mixed L functions could come from these higher dimensional objects of some deep F1 geometry. All of this is, of course, completely speculative, and I will leave the discussion of F1 here. Maybe you will someday be the one to find these new geometric paradigms and make the dream of F1 a reality. Brian Connery said in a talk once that the Riemann hypothesis is a statement about a deep connection between addition and multiplication that we do not yet understand. One of the true pioneers in F1 geometry over the last three decades is Shai Haran. I want to read the first paragraph from one of his papers. This is from New Foundations for Geometry. We spend our first years in the world of mathematics doing addition, using our fingers, and then we learn of multiplication of natural numbers as a kind of generalized addition. There is no wonder that the vast majority of structures in mathematics begin with addition, either explicitly as an abelian group or abstractly as additive abelian categories. The language of Grothendieck's algebraic geometry is based on commutative rings, having addition and multiplication. But when we compare arithmetic and geometry, we see that it is precisely the presence of addition in our language that causes all the problems. And then he goes on to explain what he means by addition causing all the problems. But both from Connery and from Haran, we can get some idea that to find a theory of F1, we might have to reimagine the core of mathematics itself, all the way down to the nature of addition and multiplication. Having thought for a long time about this deep problem, I have now arrived at the ultimate insight, and I will rewrite the foundations of mathematics in front of your very eyes. Let me present Axiom A, addition equals multiplication. Let S be any zero of the Riemann zeta function. We can always write S as x plus I y, and the aim is to prove that x equals 1/2. I'll write down 1 over S and 1 over the complex conjugate, S bar of S. So S bar means x minus iy. This is clearly equal to 1 over S and 1 over S bar again. Now, the key step is to insert axiom A into this equation, like this. We then multiply both sides by S times S bar. This gives S bar plus S equals 1. In other words, X minus IY plus X plus IY is 1. These terms cancel, and so 2X equals 1. Very good. Hence, x must equal 1/2. And this completes the proof of the Riemann hypothesis. With only the very minor issue that we're assuming axiom A. We are now at the end of the RH Saga Season 1. I will retire and await my $1 million. On behalf of the entire team behind these videos, I'd like to thank you who followed us all the way through this crazy and beautiful, but sometimes very difficult journey through the world of L functions. There may be a season two in the future, but we're not currently in a position to promise anything. I wish you the best of luck in all of your own mathematical adventures. This is now goodbye, but hopefully not forever. Goodbye.